to abide in you. May we follow the Spirit of truth through desert wild and city street, rutted field and snowbound height, battleground and market square, that your persistent love might speak to the heart of the diverse world through Jesus Christ, our brother. Amen.
Since you're further back, I'm going to move a little closer. You can't get away from this. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of John, the 14th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Those who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So the night before his death, Jesus speaks to the disciples. He says to them, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. You'll do what I've told you to do." So what has he told them to do? Earlier that night, he's knelt down before them and washed their feet. The worst job at a dinner party for this time. You've got to imagine, wearing sandals at best, barefoot, many poorer people, walking through city streets with camels and donkeys and everything that goes with them. And Jesus kneels down and washes their feet, becomes the lowest person in the room in order to help and to serve. And throughout his ministry, Jesus has been demonstrating this kind of love, this kind of service, from the beginning to the end. The heart of his ministry has been love. And at this last gathering with his disciples, after he's washed their feet, he then says to them, "Love one another as I have loved you." Encouraging them to this selfless kind of love, this service to other people. And did you know, in the Gospel of John, this is the only commandment that Jesus gives. Nowhere else does he say any other commandment to the disciples, except for, "Love one another the way I have loved you." Everything we do, everything we as believers in Jesus say, prayer, service, worship, feeding, sharing, healing, blessing, all of those things come down to one word: love. Now, in a Lutheran way of looking at Scripture, we talk about a number of different things, but one of the things we do a lot is we talk about law and gospel. Have you heard those words before? Okay, I see a few hints. It's okay to respond to me. It really is. I like it. Well, we often think of law as a commandment. But in Scripture, it's just a commandment. Law can also be anything in Scripture that holds a mirror up to us and makes us look at ourselves as we really are. The reality of our imperfections, in essence. And gospel, it's just the opposite. Gospel is what God has done for us. The gift of love, the gift of grace that has been freely given to us with absolutely no strings attached. And so any passage can be either law or gospel depending upon the time, depending on who's reading. And in fact, I know certain passages that for me that have one day come across to me as law, and it wasn't until the next time I sat down to read them that suddenly I found gospel in them. And this passage that Jesus gives us today, this commandment and these statements, to me are mixed. They're both law, love one another, but there's so much gospel embedded deep within them. Now, on the law side of this commandment to love one another makes me realize that I'm not that good at this. I don't always do this very well, because really loving can be uncomfortable. Because to really love, we have to be vulnerable. We have to open ourselves up. We have to trust. Love also requires us to cross boundaries sometimes that may seem pretty set in stone. And love can take time and effort and discipline from us. It's a lot easier to just ignore and turn our heads away from our neighbors or be afraid of them. And Jesus knows this. Jesus knows this about his disciples and about us. And so he gives this moment of gospel. God will send you another advocate to be with you forever. And again, just a little bit later, he says, I won't leave you as orphans. I won't leave you alone. I'm coming. And through this gift of the advocate, of the Holy Spirit, Jesus promises to be there, to show up, no matter what's happening, both with the disciples and with us, and to help us live fully alive as children of God. Now, that word advocate is an interesting word. The original word in the Greek, which I won't bore you with, literally means someone who comes beside you. Someone who comes alongside you. Oftentimes we hear it translated as comforter, a helper, a counselor, an encourager. But in the original context, advocate really is probably the best translation to match what was going on at the time, because the advocate was one who would plead your case, would take your side, who would intercede for you, and who would stand up for you. An advocate. We still use this word in the same exact way now. And this tends to be how we've traditionally thought of the Spirit in this passage when Jesus says, I'm going to send you an advocate. But there's a little issue with that understanding. Because it kind of implies that God needs to be persuaded to love and to forgive us. That we have to have an advocate that's going to go to God and plead our case for God. It doesn't really stand with what the rest of the Gospel of John seems to say, and which
is pretty much encapsulated in the most famous verse of Scripture in the world. Can you say it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. And then the next verse is even more important, I think. For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. David Loos, a Lutheran theologian, teacher, says this about the advocate and about this passage in particular. He says, perhaps it's actually the other way around. Perhaps it's the Spirit who intercedes on God's behalf to us. That is, perhaps the Spirit is the one who comes to remind us of our identity as children of God, as sheep who recognize the voice of our shepherd, and those for whom the good shepherd lays down his life. Because Lord knows that can be a hard identity to hold on to, a hard identity to believe is really ours, especially when we're stressed or frightened, unsure about our future, and it feels like everything has been turned upside down. He goes on to say, maybe it's the Spirit. It's that the Spirit comes alongside us and advocates for us in the face of all the challenges of the world, reminding us of Jesus' promise to be with us and for us in the face of all the things that conspire to make us doubt our worth in God's eyes, let alone the world. I know I need to hear these words all the time and be reminded that I am not alone. There's so much fear and anger and hate circulating around us in the world every day. A fear of people who are different. Fear of losing what power and privilege we might hold in life. Anger towards others who don't live or love the same way we do, and who don't express their identity in what we would label as normal or conventional ways. A fear of being rejected and suffering injury, maybe even death. And it's really easy to let the voices of those who push that narrative of fear and anger and hate drown out the voice of God. This is why we need this advocate. And the Spirit breathes inside each and every one of us, reminding us that you and I are all made in the image of God. That God is present in each and every one of us. And that God sees our pain and will never abandon us. We can see the evidence of the Spirit moving in lives around us, advocating for the love of all people, reminding us that Jesus' commandment to love as Jesus loved is more important now than ever, encouraging us to be an advocate for those whose voices have been silenced, who have little or no access to health care, to sufficient food, to rent support. We have an advocate who reminds us of God's presence. We've not been abandoned. Over the last few weeks, as I've begun to settle into the job here and get to know what happens at Faith, there have been things that I knew about already, but as I've gotten to know them better, I continue to be excited about the ministries that happen here, such as Faith House, and the many people who've come through Faith House and found a place to be, a place of safety and comfort while going through difficult treatment. Separated from family. I've learned about the
the recovery programs that meet here in our Faith Center, Cornerstone, AA, all of these wonderful groups that take people where they are and walk with them as advocates for them, reminding them that they are worth the effort to live a whole life. And there are so many other things that go on where God is active and working in our midst here. This Spirit continues to move. We're not alone. This is good news. This is pure gospel. We're not alone. We're not the only ones who are here to do the work. We might feel isolated or attacked sometimes, but we have this advocate, the one who is constantly speaking God's love into our lives day after day after day. This love of God that flows so freely down to us. And we're asked to be an advocate for others, to remind them that God has not abandoned them, but is present, even in the darkest parts of their lives. We're called to allow God's love not just to flow into us, but to flow into us and through us, out to those around us. We're not alone. We have an advocate. We have a companion to do the work and remind us of who we are. So we pray together, come Holy Spirit, fill us with your love and move us to love one another as Jesus loves us. Amen.